Well, we start our session of the last session now with the last talk of Alejandro Ibarra of On Indirect Dark Matter Searches.
All right. Yeah, so yesterday we discussed the general approach to calculate the signal from dark matter annihilation. So this proceeds in three steps: production and propagation and detection of antimatter, gamma rays, and neutrinos. Yesterday I covered antimatter. So here the idea is that antimatter particles can be produced in dark matter annihilations or decays. They propagate in a complicated way throughout the galaxy and throughout the solar system, and eventually they reach the top of the atmosphere, which is where our experiments are operating. So there is a very good measurement of the antiproton-to-proton fraction and of the positron fraction. For the antiproton-proton fraction, there is quite a good agreement between the expectations on secondary production. However, here there is a slight excess of antiprotons. Some authors have argued that this is a signal from dark matter annihilations. But as we discussed also yesterday, the propagation uncertainties are so big at the moment compared to the size of these error bars that it is a little bit far-fetched to claim detection just on the basis of this excess. For the positrons, the situation is more exciting or less clear. They are kind of related, because here from secondary production you expect a positron fraction which is monotonically decreasing. Instead, you observe this rise in the positron fraction. Again, this can be quite easily explained using dark matter annihilations or decays, but this explanation seems to be in tension with gamma ray observations and with some theoretical considerations. In any case, one can use this data to set limits on dark matter properties, and for the case of antiprotons, we saw yesterday that you can set limits or you can probe dark matter particles with masses below 1 TeV if they annihilate producing hadrons. And in the case of dark matter annihilating into leptons, for instance, E plus E minus, then you can set stringent limits on the cross section from observations of the positron fraction. So today I'm going to discuss different messengers. This is gamma rays. So this is the production of gamma rays. So we're going to follow the same program as yesterday. First we discuss the production, then the propagation, and then the detection. For the production, one can see that the gamma ray flux has two components. The first component is the inverse Compton scattering. So dark matter annihilations could produce electrons and positrons. So these electrons and positrons, they could collide with photons of the interstellar radiation field from the cosmic microwave background, from starlight, or from thermal radiation of dust. And then this energetic collision, let's say of a 1 TeV electron with a 1 EV photon, could produce a photon with an energy of several hundreds of GeV. So one could upscatter these photons from EV energies to multi-GeV energies. The spectrum, as we're going to see in a second, is smooth and is calculable. And then the second component is the prompt radiation of gamma rays. So these are the gamma rays which are directly producing the annihilation. So for example, dark matter could annihilate into B bar, and then the fragmentation of the B quark produces neutral pions, and then neutral pions could produce photons. Also, these decays or this fragmentation of the big quarks could produce electrons and positrons that could emit photons via final state radiation. So from these mechanisms, annihilations into VB bar, you produce always a smooth spectrum of gamma rays that can be quite hard in some cases. However, this component has a new feature or a new characteristic, which is that in some cases, you could produce a final state that contains spectral features. So this means, in particular, that you could produce a final state into gamma-gamma, so you have a monochromatic photon, very energetic photon, and this is going to be quite important for detection, as we will see later, because there is no astrophysical process that we know that can produce gamma ray lines. So let me just give you a flavor of what is the calculation of the inverse Compton scattering component. So as I say here, you could have electrons and positrons producing dark matter annihilations with energies of 1 TeV or less, depending on your dark matter framework. And then the galaxy is filled with photons that have energies with different wavelengths or with different energies. So you can find a smooth or a homogeneous component of photons from the cosmic microwave background radiation with energies of 10 to the minus 3 electron volts, photons with energy of 10 to the minus 2 electron volts from thermal radiation of dust, and then photons coming from the light which is emitted by the stars with energies in the visible range. So you have this collision, and in this collision you could upscatter this photon and bring it up to the GeV energies. So one can calculate that is simple kinematics to see that the upscattered photon has an energy which has an upper bound given this expression, and you can see that if you plug in these numbers, you could produce photons with energies up to 100 GeV that lie in the gamma ray range. For the prompt radiation, the calculation is slightly different. So for the annihilations, so here it depends on the source term, depends on the number of photons that you inject per unit volume and unit time. This depends on the annihilation cross-section divided by the mass squared. Okay, so this depends on the annihilation cross-section. This is the energy of photons which is produced in a given annihilation channel. In VIVA, for example, this can be measured with experiments or can be simulated with the Monte Carlo generator. And then here, one has to calculate what is the flux received at the Earth from Dramat annihilations at this point, at this point, at this point, and this point, and this point, because all these annihilations, they will produce photons, so a fraction of those will go in this direction. So since you are observing in one particular direction, you have to integrate the contributions coming from annihilations happening in this cone. So this is what is called the line of sight. And then you integrate over the annihilations occurring along this line of sight. So this depends on the density squared of the matter particles here. And as usual, since we're interested in the number density of the matter particles, not in the mass density, then you have to divide this mass density by the mass of the matter particle to calculate the number density. And for the case of the case, this is analogous. And as I say here, this energy spectrum of the final state, weighted by the branching fractions, could contain spectral features that I will discuss later with some detail, because as I say, there could be a smoking gun for dark matter annihilations. So this is basically the discussion of the production. For the propagation, it is very simple, because gamma rays, they propagate in straight lines from the production point to the Earth. And for gamma rays with energies of 1 TeV, 10 TeV, 100 GeV, one can calculate, or one can see, that absorption is quite negligible inside the galaxy. So absorption can be quite important for photons that have energies of a 100 TeV or a 1 PeV, but for this energy range, the absorption is not so significant. So propagation is simply to model the propagation as a straight line from the production point to the detection point without any significant energy loss. So the fact that gamma rays propagate in straight lines, this is a great opportunity for detection, because then you can identify different potential targets. So this is quite different to dark matter annihilations into electrons and positrons. So due to the diffusion, at the end you get a flux of electrons and positrons, which is roughly isotropic, so you lose completely any directional information about where these electrons are coming from, but this is not the case for the photons. So this is a simulated map of the galaxy, assuming that you could subtract perfectly well the galactic foregrounds. So this is just the map that would correspond to dark matter annihilations. So this figure is giving you which are the most promising targets for detection. This corresponds to these brightest points in this figure. And these are going to be the most interesting targets for detection or for searches for dark matter annihilations. So here, of course, the most prominent target is the galactic center. It is where the density is the largest. Also, it is where the backgrounds are largest, so it is not so clear that it's the optimal place to find gamma ray annihilations, but nevertheless, it's a prominent target, and there are many searches for gamma ray annihilations, for gamma ray annihilations in the galactic center. The second prominent background are the Milky Way satellites. These ones are very interesting because at these positions, backgrounds are much more reduced compared to the galactic center. Then the galactic center is a complicated region because of the last background. So what you can do is to extend your search, not right at the center, but to the whole galactic halo. So of course here the signal gets diminished, it is smaller, but also the backgrounds are smaller. And since at the end what matters is the signal to background ratio, in some cases the galactic halo could provide a signal strength which is largest than right at the galactic center. Then another possibility is to look at annihilations happening in different galaxies or in different classes of galaxies. So in different structures at high redshift, that is what is called extragalactic background. And also you can look at annihilations in galaxy clusters. So these are the possible targets, just taking into account the morphology of the signal, and one can also exploit the different morphology of the energy spectrum in order to search for annihilations, and this is what is called features in the energy spectrum, like gamma lines and so on, and this one can be looked anywhere in the sky, because there is no astrophysical process that we know that can mimic this sort of spectra. So now let me discuss what are the current state of the searches in some of these targets, the most prominent targets. The first important target are the dwarf galaxies. So this is our galaxy in gamma rays, measured by the Fermi collaboration. And these are the location of the known, or at least the known 5 years ago, now we have more dwarf galaxies that have been discovered of the Milky Way. So these ones, they correspond to these bright spots here. So in this plot, I think that there are 21 satellites. Now, as I said, there are identified 15 more. Not all of them are used in analysis. For example, Sagittarius is not used in analysis because it's very close to the galactic disk. So here you have a large contamination from gamma rays coming from galactic foregrounds. So this one is excluded from the analysis. But you can use some other of these galaxies, of these dwarf galaxies, to make a search for dark matter annihilations. So this is the list of satellites that were used for this search. And they are chosen because they are relatively close. So this means that you expect the larger flux of gamma rays. They are chosen because of being far away from the galactic disk, such that your backgrounds are reduced. And also they are chosen because they have a very large mass-to-light ratio. So you see that in some cases, the mass-to-light ratio can be up to 1,000. So this means that these objects, they have or they contain 1,000 times more dark matter than baryons, and that's why they are quite prominent targets for dark matter annihilations. Also because the few baryons that are there, they will give a very small contribution to the gamma ray flux from astrophysical processes. So you don't expect to have a large background coming from these dwarf galaxies. So now for the halo profile, this one is in principle different to the one coming from our own galaxy. So it is adopted in our black and white profile, and then with some parameters that can be determined using astronomical observations of the stars in the outermost parts of these dwarf galaxies. So this is the procedure, and then it was performed the search of gamma rays in all these objects. Of course, we hope to see a bright spot like this. Nothing like this was observed. And then using these elements of the halo profile, you can translate the upper limits on the gamma ray flux coming from these objects into upper limits on the cross-section as a function of the amateur mass assuming a concrete annihilation channel. So these are the limits corresponding to annihilation to mu plus mu minus into V bar, tau tau, and W. And something which is very notable about this search is that this search can probe quite robustly because this does not rely on any background modeling. So as I say, the expected background from these processes, from these objects, is very, very small. So it's basically a background-free search. And what you can see is that, for example, if dark matter particles annihilate in V bar, you can probe dark matter models with a mass below 100 GeV. So it's quite a remarkable achievement for these searches. So now these searches are quite relevant for dark matter scenarios, for WIMP scenarios. So this search was extended to largest masses or to largest energies by the MAGIC collaboration, and this is the limit that was released early this year, combining the measurements of the Fermi collaboration coming from these 12 galaxies together with the limits that were obtained with the MAGIC telescopes from observations of the SEGWAY-1 satellite. So you see that here you have a combined limit, which is quite good.
Okay.
Now let me move to the second target, which is to search for the diffuse flux. So in order to do this, so now we are not looking at point objects like these ones here. We are now looking at different regions in our own galaxy. So the strategy to search for annihilations in the diffuse flux is to divide the regions in, sorry, the sky in different regions. So for instance, a 3 × 3 degrees box around the galactic center. One can extend this to the galactic bulge, let's say between 5 and 30 degrees around the galactic center. One can also exclude the galactic disk just to remove backgrounds and then to make the search in a band which covers all galactic latitudes and with, sorry, all galactic longitudes and with latitude between 10 and 20 degrees, both in the North Hemisphere and the South Hemisphere. And then finally, you can make the search looking at the galactic poles. So of course here, I insist that the signal is the slowest, the smallest one, but also the background is also the smallest one. So perhaps it turns out that the signal to background ratio is largest in these regions here and not in the galactic center. So again, now here, this is not a background-free search. We have all this huge contamination from astrophysical processes and from sources. So now here, as what happened with the positrons or with antiprotons even, one has to be very careful in subtracting the backgrounds. So for gamma rays, there are two classes of backgrounds. The first one are the sources. So this is a list of the sources of the Fermilab, the first source catalog. So here, this is a catalog of point sources, consists of active galactic nuclei, pulsars, etc. Those objects emit gamma rays. And of course, you don't want to confuse these astrophysical objects, let's say, with the gamma ray emission from a dwarf galaxy. So you have to subtract all these point sources from your search. Then, in addition to the point sources, you have all this huge emission. This comes from collisions of cosmic rays with interstellar medium. So this is the Bremsstrahlung and pion decay. So in proton-proton collisions, you produce pions. So this is the map of the gamma rays produced in pion decay in one particular model of diffuse emission. So this map is following the hydrogen, basically. Then also proton-proton collisions, they emit gamma rays via Bremsstrahlung. You can see the model map here. And then from supernova remnants, they produce electrons. So these electrons propagate in the galaxy, and they can upscatter photons from the interstellar radiation field, producing a gamma ray flux from Mimes quantum processes that has this form. Okay, so of course, this one is picked in the galactic center. So at the end, you can model your background from the diffuse emission by summing these three components that we know for sure that are there in our galaxy. So this is a little bit complicated to model the gamma ray emission, especially because you have to have detailed maps of where is the gas distributed in our galaxy, so it is not trivial. And one conservative approach that you could adopt is simply to demand that the flux of gamma rays that you receive from dark matter annihilations does not exceed the Messier flux. Okay? So this doesn't require any background modeling, it's just required that your total flux that you expect is not in excess with the observed flux.
What's the level of uncertainty on those that modeling of the background?
It's quite large. It's quite large.
It's a factor.
It's a factor. The way that it's done, which is from the particle physics perspective a bit dirty, but astronomers accept it. So the way it is done is that you take one energy band, let's say between 1 and 5 GeV. So between 1 and 5 GeV, then you can model the contribution that you would get from Mimes quantum, from Bremsstrahlung, and from pion decay. And then what you do is to leave as free parameters the weight of these different components. Okay. And then what you do is that you have the map of the sky, and then what you do is that you fit the corresponding weight of these different components in the total gamma reflux, and then from making that fit, then you obtain, I don't know, that you have this inverse quantum scattering contribution will be, I don't know, a factor 0.9, this is a factor 1.3, and this is a factor 1.7, for example, in some units, whatever, no? And then, in doing this, you can model quite well what is the gamma ray emission between 1 and 5 GeV. Now you go to the beam between 5 and 20 GeV. You do the same process. And then you obtain different weights for these different templates. And it could happen that for inverse Compton, instead of being 0.7, it is 1.1. Okay? So like this, you can reproduce quite well what is the maps of the galaxy, but you have to pay the price that you have to leave floating the weight of these different templates beam by beam. Okay? So it's something that for a particle physicist is unacceptable, but for astronomers, that is the procedure that they follow. So they don't try to fit simultaneously the energy spectrum and the morphology. So overall, they can reproduce the gamma ray maps and the spectrum over quite many decades with weights for these different templates that can float, let's say, plus minus 50%. Okay? So it is not that bad. So again, it's the same as with antiprotons. The overall picture is correct, but now the data are so good that now when you go into details, then the model fails. So I think that the correct statement is that at the moment there is a good qualitative understanding of what are the processes that are producing this map. I mean, you can see that here, these structures, for example, you can reproduce quite well with your models. So I think that you can reproduce the big picture. But then when you go into details, both in the morphology and the energy spectrum, then you fail at the moment. I will go back to that point later, because that is quite important for the claim of an excess coming from the galactic center region.
And it would depend then on the energy, right?
Yes, exactly, yeah.
Probably
there's larger. Yeah. Yeah, that's why many people, they think that the appropriate procedure, at least in order to, I mean, again, to claim detection is going to be difficult. It's going to be difficult because you want to understand the patterns well, but you can always use this data to set constraints on your dark matter parameters. This is what these people did. So for example, here you can again assume a concrete annihilation channel, a concrete halo profile, and then this is the expected gamma ray flux if dark matter has a mass of 1.5 TeV annihilates into mu plus mu minus with a cross section which is 3 × 10⁻³. Okay. So here I want to show this plot for several reasons. So the first reason is so that you can see what is the relevant impact of the different components of the gamma ray flux. So this is the prompt component. So from muons, you only get a prompt component coming from finite state radiation. But then you see that here, most of the spectrum, or most of the flux, is dominated not by this prompt component, but by the inverse quantum component. So these muons, they decay producing electrons and positrons. They will encounter photons from the interstellar radiation field. And then this is the gamma ray flux that you obtain from upscattering photons from starlight into gamma ray energies because of these electrons and positrons that are in the galaxy. This is the same contribution from gamma rays coming from the photons of the interstellar radiation field, and these are the photons from CMB. So here you have a photon with an energy of 10⁻³ electron volts. So this photon collides with an electron with an energy of 1.5 TeV or 1 TeV, and then this collision brings these photons into these gamma ray energies. And then you can see that the total spectrum that you obtain by including the inverse quantum scattering component is very different to the one that you obtain only taking into account the prompt component. To the extent that if you include the prompt component, then there is no tension with the data, because here this prompt component peaks in a region where there is no measurement. But then if you take into account this inverse quantum component, then you get a flux which is very clearly in excess with the data. So this implies that this particular scenario is ruled out just from considering the inverse quantum component of the gamma ray flux. And the second reason why I want to show this plot is because these are parameters that were used in the past in order to reproduce the positron excess. So this means that if the positron excess is explained by these parameters, and indeed it is explained by these parameters, then you would expect to have an accompanying gamma reflex which is in big tension with the experiment. You would have expect to have here, to see here, this bump at 10 GeV. So you can do this with different regions. It's not very important here. And then at the end, these are the limits that you can produce on the cross-section as a function of the mass for a given final state from observations of the gamma reflex in the 3 times 3 box around the galactic center, in the 5 times 30 degrees box around the galactic center, this search excluding the galactic disk and take into account the all galactic latitudes and all galactic longitudes and latitudes between 10 and 20 degrees, and this comes some observations of the galactic poles. So there is some complementarity, but what is clear is that the cross section, which is, let's say, 10 to the minus 23, is excluded at least by two different searches. And this is quite conservative and quite robust because this search does not require any background modeling. So this search is interesting as it stands here because you can probe this region of the planetary space that was favored by the Poisson excess, but at least this search is not sensitive enough to probe this region of 3 times 10 to the minus 26, which is the one expected for WIMPs. So this means that if you want to go down to this region, then you have to do better than just making this conservative approach. Then this means that you have to take into account the foreground, and then you have to model the foreground if you want to probe cross sections as small as 3 times 10 to the minus 26. So this is quite challenging, but also quite interesting. So this the first attempt to do this with the Fermi data was done by Goodenough and Hooper at the end of 2009. But this search got a lot of attention in 2014 for reasons that I will describe now in a minute. So what these authors did was to take the region with galactic latitude below 5 degrees and galactic longitude below 5 degrees, so it's the truly the galactic center region. And this is the map of gamma rays that you obtain in this region at energies between 0.3 and 1 GeV, between 1 and 3.1 GeV, and between 3.1 GeV and 10 GeV. And as expected, here you have quite a large emission coming from the galactic center. Now here, again, you can make this search for annihilations, not taking into account the background modeling, and then you would obtain limits which are comparable to these ones here. Now these people, they want to do it better, so they try to simulate the foreground. So what they did is to subtract the sources from the source catalog from the Fermi LAT. And then they took a particular, and that goes in your direction, a particular special template for diffuse galactic emission, consisting of some Pi0 components, some Bremsstrahl component, and some ICS component. So it's the map that they obtained with this template. They also subtracted the Fermi bubbles, which are some objects which are not yet understood what is the range of these bubbles, but we know for sure that they are there, and they extend up to 45 or 50 degrees of galactic latitude. So this is subtracted, and also they subtracted the isotropic extragalactic component. This one is also difficult to model, but they made some assumptions and they subtracted this component. And then after subtracting all these different sources of gamma rays from the galactic center region, this is what they obtained. What they obtained is that they were not able to account for all the gamma ray emission that was observed, but instead there was a residual. And this residual appeared in all these 3 energy bands. And furthermore, this residual is quite intriguing because it is roughly spherically symmetric and also centered at the galactic center. So being spherical, this suggests that it could have something to do with Fermat annihilations. Yeah. And then what it did also was to calculate what is the energy spectrum of the excess. So you see that the excess is quite significant, so this corresponds to no excess. And then instead, they obtain a residual with a spectrum which is like this, so there is clearly an excess coming from the galactic center. And this line here corresponds to the prediction or to the expectation For the gamma ray flux in the galactic center, assuming an FW profile which is a little bit contracted, a little bit modified, but still within what is theoretically plausible. And then this line corresponds to an equation to B bar with a mass equal to 35 GeV and with a cross section which is about 10 to minus 26 centimeter cube per second. So it is quite exciting, and that is what attracted a lot of attention from the community, because the morphology is exactly morphology that you would expect from Dalmat annihilations. And then the energy spectrum that you obtain from the signal. Yes, because dark matter is supposed to be spherically symmetric around the galactic center, and this is exactly what you expect. And for example, here you see that this emission, which is kind of flat, this is what is expected from astrophysical processes, because this is the galactic disk. The galactic disk has hydrogen, that we know for sure. And then this hydrogen could be the target for proton-proton collisions, and then this would produce pion decay, and then most of this emission here corresponds to pion decay and bremsstrahlung from proton-proton collisions in the disk. Okay. So this one is clearly from astrophysical origin, and that's why he has this flat morphology, because it is correlated with the morphology of the disk of our galaxy. But the fact that the residual is spherically symmetric, this suggests that it could have something to do with dark matter annihilations, because that's the morphology that you expect, yeah, precisely. I will go again to this point in a few minutes. Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, this is quite exciting because it is a mass and a cross section in the ballpark of what you expect from dark matter annihilations, from WIMPs. Of course, the galactic center is complicated, so perhaps they were forgetting something in this list of components of the gamma ray emission. So then what they did was to extend the search to a region which is farther away. Let's say extend it to galactic latitude up to 20 degrees, and then here masking the galactic disk. So it is here where all this astrophysical junk is taking place, so that's when it's difficult to model, to understand. So then, they subtracted this part, which is the most conflicted one. And then again, they were finding this residual with a shape which is roughly spherically symmetric. And then this is the corresponding spectrum that they inferred from this residual emission coming now from the galactic, not from the galactic center, but from the galactic bulge. And what is remarkable is that the parameters for dark matter properties that best fit this excess in the galactic bulge are pretty much the same as the ones that fit the excess in the galactic center. So this is really exciting because now you have a signal which appears systematically in different parts of the galactic center galactic bulge region, so it is with the similar parameters and with the correct morphology. Now, it is what you were pointing out before. Is this excess really due to dark matter annihilations, or it is due to the fact that these authors considered a particular spatial template for the diffuse emission? So then subsequently,
would explain both.
It would explain, well, it's not so clear because this one is much more extended. Okay, so it is not really, it's not really in the galactic center, but it could be the case. So then what these authors did, so some people did this, was to consider different galactic diffuse emission models, in total 60 different galactic diffuse emission models, of course diffuse emission models that were compatible with born to carbon, with the gamma rays in other parts of the sky, etc., compatible with all other observations. And then in all these models, they were finding an excess. So they could not find a model where you could absorb all this excess. And in all the cases, what they found is that no matter what is the diffuse emission you find, it is fitted quite well by dark matter annihilations into quarks, into V-bar, into CC, for example, with a mass which is about 50 GeV for the case of annihilation to big quarks, or 40 GeV for the case of annihilations into some quarks, and with a cross-section which is, again, the ballpark of the one that you expect for WIMPs. So here I should say that This excess can also be fitted by a broken power law. So you see that the p-value is quite similar for annihilations and for the broken power law. But nevertheless, the explanation of the mad annihilations seems to be robust at this stage. So it is not a matter of a mismodeling of the negative foreground. What is now clear, and this is still the present state of the art, what is clear is that there is an excess in gamma rays in the galactic center. That is now quite established. And this excess cannot be explained by any of these components. Now the question is, what is this excess? So of course the explanation that we would like to have is that this is an indication for the mad annihilations, but it could be something else. Now these authors also explore what would be the morphology of the excess. So what they did was to divide this region where the excess was found, so between 1 and 20 degrees in galactic latitude, and between minus 20 and 20 degrees in galactic longitude, in different regions. Now, only from theory considerations, you expect that the dark matter signal, if it is truly a dark matter signal, should be north-south symmetric, should be east-west symmetric, and should have a strength that decreases as you go away from the galactic center. And of course, you also expect, since it comes from annihilations in the bar, you would expect that the spectrum of gamma rays in all these regions should be exactly the same, should be picked at the same energy and should have the same form. And this is exactly what they found. So this is, for example, this is region 1 and region 2, so this is north and south, so it's in the innermost part of the search. So you see that in both cases, the spectrum is picked at a few GeV, and it has roughly the same intensity. So the signal is indeed north-south symmetric. Now when you go very far away from the galactic center to region 10, it is this one here, then you still have a small excess, okay? But still this excess is picked at a few GeV. And of course now the excess is weaker, because also from the mad annihilations, you expect the excess to be largest in the galactic center, and then weaker as you go away, because here the rate of annihilations is smaller. And furthermore, in all these different search regions, or these different 10 search regions, in all these ones, you can fit independently, which is the best parameters for the matter model that fit this excess. And in all the cases, they converge to the same region. So they converge to a dark matter mass of about 50 GeV, and with a cross-section, which is about 0.2, I don't know, with this unit, maybe it is 10 to the minus, maybe normalized to the thermal cross-section. So it's quite exciting. It could be the first indication for dark matter annihilations, but yesterday we also saw two other possible indications for dark matter annihilations. So now this is the moment when one has to be really critical and one has to be as extractive as possible with this signal. So the advantage of the dark matter framework is that in making this, we have already fixed all the three parameters of the model. So we have fixed the mass, we have fixed the cross-section, and then we can make predictions for observables in different parts of the galaxy. So in particular, if these annihilations are taking place in the galactic center to produce this excess, these annihilations should take place also in dwarf galaxies, in galaxy clusters, at large distances, and so on. So this is the expected flux, or the expected cross-section, that different authors inferred from the galactic center excess, from the galactic center emission, and these are the limits from dwarf galaxies that we discussed before. So it's the combined limit from these 15 dwarf spherical galaxies using the past 8 Fermilat data. So this is the first blow for this explanation for the galactic center excess, namely that if you see all the regions which are favored by different authors for the parameters of this galactic center excess, they are in tension with the limits coming from dwarf galaxies. Or in other words, if the galactic center excess would have been due to dark matter annihilations, then you would have expected to see also an excess in dwarf galaxies, and this excess was not observed. So here we are talking about dark matter annihilating to B-bar. So this means that these big quarks, after fragmentation, they could produce antiprotons, they will produce antiprotons, and these antiprotons should be received at the Earth. So this is something that I pointed out yesterday, that was quite of a recent discovery that the parameters that best fit this antiproton excess that I mentioned yesterday seem to converge with the parameters that best fit the galactic bulge emission. So it's one of the reasons why these two papers have attracted some interest, because both observations, galactic center gamma ray emission and these antiproton measurements, they seem to converge towards the same region of the particle space, with the caveat that this region is in tension with the Fermi observations of dwarf galaxies. And again, with the caveats that I mentioned yesterday about how to use or how to claim a signal in antiprotons in view of our limited knowledge of propagation parameters. But anyways, this is a test. Also, some people claimed that you should have observed a signal in radio waves, and this signal was not observed. So again, it is one of these elements that are against this Darmada interpretation of this galactic center excess. And finally, here we have a particular or a concrete particle physics model. So here we have dark matter that couples to big quarks, and the strength of this interaction is fixed by the requirement of producing the galactic bulge emission. So this means that you can make predictions for the scattering rate of dark matter particles with nuclei, and that one could be tested in direct detection experiments. So these are the different limits from direct detection experiments, from spin-dependent and the spin-dependent interaction as a function of time. So this is the current limit for the spin-dependent and the spin-independent interaction. And then these are the predictions of some of these models. So this is the list of models that could produce the galactic center excess. So here you have Dirac fermion dark matter that couples to a scalar mediator with the interaction which is axial-like. And then this particular model, as I say, it can explain the galactic center excess, but in this case it will produce a scattering rate which is out of the reach of the last experiment, of the Xenon-Wanton experiment, and of the LSET experiment. So in some cases you could probe some of those interpretations. So in fact, the ones which are not here are the ones which are excluded currently by the detection experiments. Some of these interpretations, some of those models could be tested in the next few years, and then some others could be out of the reach of experiments forever. But anyways, this is another chance for testing this interpretation of the galactic center excess. And finally, and this is perhaps the latest developments, I would say, is that when we discussed the different contributions from the background emission, if I can go back to this slide, we talked about the known sources, we talked about the diffuse components, about the bubbles, and about the static component. But here it's only included the known sources. So what would happen if there are unknown sources, or sources that are there, that are not resolved, but nevertheless emitting gamma rays in significant amounts to contribute to the total flux? So one example of this are millisecond pulsars, and they have been proposed as an explanation of this excess. Also, these models, they assume the stationary regime, but it could happen in the past that was the large activity from the galactic center. For example, there could be a burst event that is injecting hadrons, and these hadrons could produce gamma rays. And also, it could have a burst event injecting electrons, and then those electrons producing gamma rays via inverse quantum scattering. So there are different explanations that have been proposed to explain the galactic center excess. These two are now disfavored. And this one is now, according to many people, the most likely explanation for the galactic center emission. So this is the map of the simulated photon counts in a region which is 20 times 20 degrees around the galactic center. And this is the big difference between these two scenarios. So if you only have dark matter annihilations, then you would expect this distribution to be spherical isometric. But if you have emission coming from point sources, from millisecond pulsars, then you would expect this gamma ray flux to be concentrated in some points because it is a point source emission. Now, if you have a bad angular resolution, then this map could look exactly the same as this map. And that is what could be happening in Fermi. In Fermi, at least with the present measurements, given the poor energy resolution, it could happen, or it happens, that these two maps look pretty similar, not exactly the same, but they look pretty similar, and it could be difficult, I mean, you could be misinterpreting a data signal as a signal coming from point sources. Okay, so this is complicated by the fact that you don't have the signal isolated, you also have the diffuse background. So this is the expected diffuse background when you have a data component, so it's the total flux, diffuse plus dark matter, and this is the total flux you have diffuse plus point sources.
So if you add, for example, the contribution from the pulsars, so you also need to modify the for example, the inverse quantum scattering, the model that you have, because there will be now another source of gamma, right? So how that?
No, not necessarily, because these millisecond pulsars, they are emitting gamma rays with an energy of a few GeV. So now the question is how, or what is the energy of the electrons that these pulsars are injecting? And that is what we don't know. That's why yesterday we had all these fits to the data. But if these pulsars are injecting electrons with an energy of, let's say, 10-20 GeV, these ones, they will produce inverse quantum scattering, but that one will evict at much lower energies. So this one, they will not contribute to the galactic center excess. Yeah. Yeah. So now here the point, okay. The point is that these two maps are very similar, at least at first sight, but you see that there are some small differences between this map and this map. So what these two groups did, using different techniques, one in Amsterdam and one in the US, one in Princeton plus MIT, was to use some statistical techniques in order to see whether the actual Fermi data, whether they are more similar to this map, or whether they are more similar to this map. Or, in other words, whether the Fermi data looks more like a diffuse plus dark matter map, or like a diffuse plus point source map. And then what they infer with different techniques, as I say, is that the Fermi data looks more like this map here. So, for example, here, the group by Amsterdam, they say that we detect a clustering of photons, so this is this clustering here, as predicted by the hypothetical population of millisecond pulsars with a significance of 10 sigma. So this means that the morphology of the signal is much better reproduced if you have a population of millisecond pulsars compared to when you have a population of dark matter particles annihilating. And they say that this distribution fits the data quite well. Now here the question is about the luminosity of those pulsars, but they say that with reasonable parameters for this luminosity function, it is possible also to explain not only the morphology, but also the strength of the emission. And then similar conclusions were reached by the group in the US, saying that the excess is fully absorbed by the population in preference to the matter annihilation. So at the end, the conclusion is that it seems that this excess, even though it has all the characteristics for dark matter annihilations, it seems that this excess is due to a population of point sources not yet detected. So it has been detected, the combined emission from all these point sources, but not yet the point sources. So now here the critical test for this interpretation for the galactic patch excess is to have an experiment on a satellite with a much better angular resolution, and this experiment should be able to start seeing more and more sources in the galactic center. And luckily, there are going to be some missions in the next few years with sensitivity, which is precisely in the energy range relevant for the galactic center excess, and with an angular resolution that will be able to discover most of these sources that were postulated to exist in the galactic center. This will be, for example, Gamma 400 that will be launched in 2021. So we have to wait a little bit, but in principle, also this millisecond pulsar interpretation of the galactic center excess can be tested in experiments. But again, this is another warning about how important are the backgrounds in order to claim the detection of the matter signal in the sky. So you can always use this data to set limits, but if you want to claim a signal, you have to be very, very careful, and you have to take into account many, many astrophysical considerations, which are sometimes very poorly understood. How much time do I have, Miriam? 15. Bien. Bien. Okay, so in the last part of this presentation, I would like to discuss gamma ray features. So here the idea is to search for a gamma ray excess with an energy spectrum which is different from the background. So here we don't rely on any background modeling. So here the only assumption is that the background coming from astrophysical processes is a smooth background. And then here we are going to search, I mean, exploiting the fact that we know from particle physics that matter particles could annihilate producing sharp spectral features, we're going to use this fact in order to search for dark matter annihilations. So here I had an example, but unfortunately it disappeared and I could not find the replacement so quickly. So forget about these slides. So this is a study for searches about how does it work, how can one search so efficiently a gamma ray line in the sky. So imagine that the matter particles annihilate producing monochromatic photons. So this means that the matter particles annihilate into gamma-gamma. The matter mass is equal to 100 GeV. Therefore, this annihilation process will produce a gamma line at an energy of 100 GeV. So it is a line, but then in your instrument, it will look like a Gaussian, like we have here. Now, assume for the moment that your background for astrophysical processes is a simple power law. Then the total spectrum will be a simple power law with a small bump here. So then what you can do is very simple. You can fit your data to a simple power law plus this monochromatic line. And then you can compare what is the goodness of the fit for this model compared to the goodness of the fit if you only have the simple power law. And then in doing this, you can set upper limits on the size of this B parameter here, which is related to the size of the annihilation cross-section for a given mass. That is the general idea. That is something which is, in principle, straightforward. However, the data are not a simple power law. So it is very similar to a simple power law, but not exactly a simple power law. And again, since here the error bars are so, so small, it is not possible to model your background in this whole energy range as simple power law. So now it is one of these limitations of having good data that now approximations that you were doing here, you cannot do it anymore. But now here one can exploit the fact that the signal is concentrated in a very, very narrow energy range. And this is the critical point. So this means that you can just take this window, which is some energy beings below the mass that you are searching for, a few energy beings above the mass that you are searching for, and then you know from elementary mathematics that any curve, no matter how complicated it is, locally it always looks like a power law. So this means that this approach, that I think is quite convincing, you can apply it when you are making the search in this very, very small energy window. Now you can repeat this exercise at different masses or for different energies. This is what is called the sliding energy window approach. And then you can make a search for gamma ray lines at different energies. And this is the result of the search that was performed by the Fermi collaboration in 2012 for different wind masses. And this is an annihilation into gamma-gamma, assuming different halo profiles. And something which is quite remarkable about this plot is that you see, for example, 100 GeV, it is possible to constrain cross sections down to 10 to the minus 27. So the thermal cross section is 3 times 10 to the minus 26. If you remember from the diffuse emission, we could constrain annihilation cross sections that were 10 to the minus 23, something like here. But with 34 gamma lines, because of having here this very, very good data, because of having here this very clever approach, it is possible to probe cross sections of the order of 10 to the minus 27. So this means that we are probing signals that have a strength which is 3 orders of magnitude smaller than the background. So we are looking for a very, very faint signal. That's quite exciting because it is very well below the thermal cross section, but one can do even better. So the approach that I explained before, that was the approach adopted by the Fermi collaboration, consisted in taking this region of the sky, so it is just taking the whole sky, you remove the galactic disk, and then you keep the galactic center. So, of course, a good strategy to search for gamma lines. But here, this choice of the target region has the disadvantage that you have here lots of regions, lots of points, that are contributing to your background but are not contributing to the signal. So this means that this search region is not optimal in terms of signal to background. So this means that you can improve the search if you choose your search region in a way that optimizes the signal to background region. This is what we did here some years ago, and this is the optimized region, assuming a halo profile which is Navarro, Frank, and White. And this approach turned out to be quite successful because we could detect a gamma line or a gamma spectral feature at 130 GeV that attracted a lot of attention for a while. And then with more data, this signal disappears. It was just a statistical fluke. But nevertheless, this approach, as I said, was quite interesting in order to improve the search or improving the reach of the FEMI experiment to constrain sharp gamma ray spectral features. So now you see that at 100 GeV, now we can improve the search practically down to 10 to the minus 28 centimeter cube per second. So now this approach was adopted by the FEMI collaboration, not by taking these complicated regions, but by taking simplified optimized regions, these hourglass regions, and these are the latest limits on gamma lines reported by the FEMI collaboration last year. And you can see here that at 100 GeV, there is now 10 to the minus 28. Of course, this is a combination of having these optimized regions, but also of having more years of data taking. This has been extended to larger energies. Of course, this is a satellite, so for Cherenkov telescopes, it is much more complicated, but these are the limits that were produced by the Hertz collaboration. Actually, they have been improved. I don't know why I have it here, but now the limits that have been released by the Fermi collaboration are of this order or even better. Do I have 7 minutes, 8 minutes, 5 minutes? Okay. Okay, so since in this audience there are many particle physicists, I think it's appropriate to discuss what are the implications for these searches for particle physics models, because this is purely phenomenological. And so just to say that there have been three, from particle physics perspective, three possible sharp spectral features identified in concrete models. So gamma ray lines, internal Bremsstrahlung, and gamma ray boxes. And these are the spectrum that you can see here for these different frameworks compared to the spectrum that you expect from annihilations into quark anti-quark WW, which is much smoother. So this one, you see, it is, has a high rise and then has a sharp cutoff. And of course, this one should be compared with the typical spectrum from the astrophysical background, which is basically the energy to the minus 2.7 in the galactic center. So here, this always shows up in the data, or should show up in the data, as a bump and then with a sharp cutoff at high energies. So, yeah, so here I mentioned that we have this fantastic measurement in the minus 28 for the limit compared to 3 times in the minus 26. Now the question is, how relevant are these limits for concrete models? So gamma ray lines are practically automatic in dark matter models because the wind paradigm postulates that the matter particles interact in pairs with the standard model particles. And, well, almost all the standard model particles have electric charge, so you can take this diagram, that is the one that induces the dark matter freeze out. You can take this charge standard model particles, you can close a loop and then attach two photons. It's not something that you can always do. So this means that these monochromatic signals are quite generic in wind models. Now you can also estimate what is the cross-section for these models. So this would be the thermal cross-section, that is the strength of this effective interaction. And then you must have a suppression by alpha squared, and then a suppression by the growth factor. So at the end, you expect, typically, not always, but typically, you expect cross-sections for annihilation to gamma-gamma of the order of 10 to the minus 32 centimeter cube per second. So now we can go back to this figure. These are the Fermi limits. This is the canonical value for the cross-section, 3 times in the minus 26. And this is, unfortunately, the cross-section that you expect in most models, not always, but in most models, for the cross-section into gamma-gamma. So this is a bit of a pity because you have this amazing sensitivity for the experience for gamma lines, but unfortunately, these limits are not relevant for most of the models. In some models, they can be relevant, and in fact, these limits currently rule out some others, but that is requires some extra elements in your Dharma Tar framework. So the second signal, which is perhaps less trivial and less known, is what is called the internal Bremsstrahlung. So this one requires a new element, which is the existence of a mediator which is exchanged in the T-channel. So it's very important to have the matter particles that are created in some of the particles via the exchange of a mediator in the T-channel. So why is this important? Now you can consider the higher order process with annihilation with one photon, extra photon in the final state. So now this photon can be attached to the external legs. Or this photon could be attached to the internal leg here in the T-channel. Because if you have here an electron, for example, then this mediator necessarily must have electric charge, must be a selectron in the case of supersymmetry. So why is this interesting? So now, in order to see why or how this spectral feature arises, you can consider the propagator of this mediator here. So the propagator is the momentum squared minus the mass of the mediator, all that to the power of minus one. And now you can expand this momentum of the mediator, which is the momentum of the matter particle minus momentum of the sum of the particle. You can expand it in the limit where distant matter particles have low velocity, which is the case in the galactic center. So if you assume also that the standard model particle is massless or have a small mass, for example, here you can consider electrons, taus, big quarks, something like this, then the expansion of this term gives you the matter mass squared coming from the mass squared. The standard model particle mass squared is equal to zero or close to zero. And then from the closed term, you only obtain this term because, as I said, we assumed that these matter particles have a low velocity. Now the interesting regime arises when the dark matter mass is close to the mediator mass. This happens in particular in supersymmetry in the co-annihilation region. So if you assume that the matter particles are generated with the mediator mass, then your propagator is simply this one, and then what you see is that your propagator blows up when the energy of this dark matter particle is very small. And then this means that if the energy of this model particle is small, just out of kinematical reasons, this implies that the energy of this photon is going to be large. So the conclusion is that if the dark matter mass is close to the mediator mass, so you have to have these two ingredients, these two must be the generating mass, then you expect to find an enhancement of the cross-section or a peak in the energy spectrum when the energy of this photon is large, when the energy of this photon is close to the kinematical endpoint. This is what you can see in this figure here. So this is the expected annihilation, expected flux from annihilation multiplied by x squared, doesn't matter, when this mediator mass is very close to the matter mass. And then you can see here that you expect to see this sharp pump towards the endpoint of the spectrum, which is very similar, given the energy resolution of our instruments, is very similar to a gamma ray line. So remember here that the spectrum of the background falls like the energy to the minus 2.7. So you can estimate what is the cross-section that you expect today for these processes. So if for the thermal cross-section you have 3 times the minus 26, then for this 2 to 3 process you expect a suppression of order alpha and a suppression of order pi, because you have here a 3-body annihilation. And this is why this process is interesting compared to the gamma lines, because gamma lines are suppressed by alpha squared, and this one is suppressed only by alpha. So this means that the expected cross-section for these processes is much, much larger than the one for lines. So this means that these processes could be at the risk of experiments. These are the limits on the cross-section for this process, annihilation to mu plus mu minus and gamma, with the Fermilat data, only it was 4 years of data. Compare. This is the canonical value, and now here we have to compare with the expected cross-section for WIMPs. So for the case of lines, if you remember, the expected cross-section was 3/4 of magnitude below the current limits. In this case, you see that the current limits are only a factor of a few from the expected value of the cross-section for thermal WIMPs, for thermal dark matter. So this means that if experiments could increase sensitivity by a factor of 10, then you could probe the parameter space where you expect to have a sharp spectral feature in these kind of processes. Or in other words, if these are the models which are realized in nature, for that matter, then you expect to see a signal in the form of a surface spectral feature, which is quite a spectacular signal, with an increase of sensitivity of a factor of 5 or 10. Okay, I think that my time is almost done, so I think that I'm going to skip the boxes. And just maybe to finish saying that there is a bright future for dark matter search is using gamma rays. So this may be in contrast with antimatter, because I don't think that there will be any new mission after AMS2, searching for cosmic antiprotons or for positrons at those energies at least. But in gamma rays, now we have many new instruments in operation, such as HESS or HOC here in Mexico, or in construction, CTA, which is actually now some of the first telescopes are being installed. And then DAMPE, that is a satellite, that is a Chinese mission that was launched in 2015. And then in the longer term, well, longer term, in 5 years from now, there will be a new mission that is a joint enterprise between Italy and Russia for this satellite with a fantastic energy and angular resolution that is expected to be launched in 2021. Okay, so these are some concluding remarks of this set of lectures. The first one is that the observation of a dark matter annihilation signal would be a groundbreaking discovery, both for particle physics and for cosmology, because then you could probe the physics at very, very early times, much earlier than the ones that we can probe now with Viva nucleosynthesis. Also, for the first time, experiments in positrons, antiprotons, and gamma rays are ruling out regions of the matter space which are favored by some wind models, especially wind models with a low mass, accumulating into B bar or E plus E minus. However, the identification of a signal in indirect searches is much more difficult. It's much more difficult because in order to detect a signal, or to claim a signal, you have to understand your backgrounds, and this is actually not an easy task because it implies objects which are very, very far away from us, and we cannot go there to make experiments. Okay. So this means that you want to claim a signal, it is not just as easy as to search in a single place, but that you have to, first of all, reduce your backgrounds, and furthermore, you have to use a multi-messenger, namely to see a signal which is correlated both in electrons, positrons, gamma rays, neutrinos, antiprotons. Also, multi-wavelength, namely you have to see a signal in gamma rays, in radio, in X-rays. And in, furthermore, it would be even better if you could see a signal also in other search strategies, not only in indirect searches, but also in direct searches and in colder searches. So of course, this is not going to be an easy task, but this is what one has to do in order to establish the particle nature of the dark matter. So thank you for your attention.
Well, we thank Alejandro for this very nice set of lectures. Are there any questions? So what is the nature of this dark matter mediator? So the mediator between dark matter and the standard models, the standard model particles.
Yeah, it is not known. It is not known. I mean, in this particular setup that I mentioned here, it can be anything. I mean, you know, for example, well, the thing that you know is that this standard model particle should be, I mean, a fermion, could be an electron, for example, could be W plus, W minus, but all the rest is not known. So, for example, you could have this dark matter particle to be a marginal fermion. I mean, since you are a supersymmetry person, could be a bino that annihilates into a big quark via the exchange of a B quark, of a spoton. So you could have here a marginal fermion, and here the mediator could be scalar. Now, dark matter particles could also be scalars. There is one model which is called the inner tablet model, that is exactly the same as the Higgs particle, but with an additional set to symmetry that makes it stable. So in this case, this dark matter particle scalar annihilates into W plus W minus. It annihilates in that way in several diagrams, but in particular, you would have the inert scalar neutral particle, here the exchange of a charge scalar, and then here the W boson. That's a possibility. You could have also here the matter scalar, scalar matter, Standard model fermion, and then here we could also have a vector like fermion mediator. So we have here all these different possibilities. Yeah. And that is quite important, maybe not for indirect searches, but it is very important for collider searches. Because it's quite difficult to produce the matter particles in colliders directly, because they are weak interacting. But what you can do here is to produce spotons, that is going in the direction of Chester's lectures. You could produce spotons, and then the spotons will decay into bottoms and miss energy. So this mediator also offers a new window for probing the dark sector via collider searches.
More questions? You sure? I have more questions. How do the astrophysicists subtract backgrounds? So you say I have to subtract this. How do they do it?
Yeah, they do it in a very dirty way. That is what I discussed before with Eric, that it's really complicated, yeah. Yeah, I mean, what they do is that they take the map of hydrogen in the galaxy that they infer from astronomical observations. I don't know exactly how they do it, but they can infer this map. And then they inject protons into the galaxy. And then they assume that the spectrum of protons is the same locally as in the whole galaxy. And then with that, you can simulate the production or the collision of these protons, cosmic ray protons, with the protons of the interstellar medium. And then you can model what is the contribution to the gamma ray flux from Bremsstrahlung and pion decay, for example. That is the particles that you produce in the collision. Now, the problem is that you don't know exactly, or you have some uncertainties, of what is the density of hydrogen in these places. So that's why they can float the normalization of all these different templates. And then what they do is not the only free parameter. But what they do is that they float all these different templates in order to fit the data. And they do that bin by bin.
So they have large uncertainties there?
They have large uncertainties, yes. Into my understanding, there is not yet a model for the diffuse emission that can fit the observations at the same time in the whole space and at all energies. And the reason why they cannot do that is because the measurements are very good, simply very good. Yeah. So I mean, when the error bars are, let's say, a factor of 2, it's quite easy to fit the data but now the data is so good and you have so high quality of data. I mean, here, well, I don't know, but I don't have here the map. Yeah, exactly. So here you have a very detailed map, both in energy and in angular span. And yeah, it's going to be very difficult to explain this. It's like with fluid models, you're familiar with that. It's quite difficult to reproduce. If you're making a random scan of the parameters, it's quite difficult to reproduce the fermion masses, simply because the electron mass is known to the Permirion levels. Of course, it's quite difficult to reproduce all the data at the same time, no? So this is now the problem that these people are facing.
Yeah. Any more questions? If not, let's thank Alejandro again for his lectures. Okay.